listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com. And streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Bar Rescue After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Bar Rescue After Show.
Hi, welcome, everybody. Bing is for doing it, and we are doing the season premiere of Bar Rescue. We are wrapping up season two. This is episode 10 called Bikini Bust. It used to be called Extremes over in Orange, California. I'm Kimlai, your host, and joined here this evening with my co-host, Dorinda Barker.
Hi, guys. How are you? Bikini Bust. Wow, that just says a lot about this episode.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
They were busted. Hey, you know what? We're gonna get right into this, guys. What about the I want to talk about that sign on the outside where it just said extreme. It was not inviting. It didn't look. I wouldn't have wanted to go there.
No, there's nothing about that was very inviting. It was actually kind of scary, if you wanted to know. I didn't like it at all, and it looked like a creepy, like bar. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm a woman. I wouldn't go in there.
Oh, and that says a lot.
Yeah, I would.
Seriously.
Yeah, it does, because that's what you want. You want women in there. If women go to a bar, men will go to a bar. If men go to a bar, men will buy. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's how you make money.
All right, clothes.
What or what there was lack of.
I'm really, really glad they did end up getting uniforms. You know, some of the. What were you, Amir? You were like, oh my God, I think there's only like two people that actually are pretty on that. And not everyone should be in a bikini. All of these girls were pretty fit, but I thought some of the butts were a little, it was too much. Too much. A little bit too much jiggling the wiggle going on back there. Needed to be covered up. My opinion.
Well, I thought. Thank you, Amir. To be honest with you, as being a bikini bar, I could understand everything. I don't think they should have wore thongs. To me, that's just not...
Exactly.
That's not sanitized. That's not hygienic to me. There is nothing... I don't want your butt touching, because things touch.
Yeah, no. And honestly, if I'm going to go to a bar, I want to see... I mean, I do appreciate pretty people, you know, men and women.
Yes.
And it's... I want them to be attractive. I don't want to see... an ass walking away from me that has cellulite on it with a G-string going up the butt. That's not appealing to me. And I don't want to sit there and eat. I don't want to sit there and drink having to watch that.
Yes.
So I'm with you on the whole G-string.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, we all have it. It's, come on, not all of us are Kim Kardashian and can wear that.
Well, some of that.
Well, yeah, she can't wear it either, really. Okay. Woo! Was that an example?
Not sure.
Not to say that she isn't beautiful, because I definitely think she's beautiful.
We're talking about the butt.
Yeah.
Talking about the butt. I thought it was very interesting how Terry, who is the bar owner, saw the ad in the paper. Granted, he has owned other businesses, construction businesses, but he just saw an ad in the paper and thought, oh, this looks like something I want to buy. It reminds me, I watched this episode on the restaurant one. Oh, the restaurant one that's just like Bar Rescue, but it's
Hell's Kitchen?
Nope. Restaurant Rescue.
Oh, Restaurant Impossible.
Thank you very much. That's it. And one of the episodes a few weeks ago, there was just an ad in the paper. They went to an auction. And just thought, well, what the heck? It's just, we're bored today. Let's go bid on a restaurant. And they did. And it's the same thing. They had no idea how to run a restaurant. And obviously, it didn't seem like he really knew how to run a bar. Just because you can run a business doesn't mean you can run a bar.
Because it's a totally different animal. And it seems like Terry bought a bar to mask a couple other things.
Yes. And, you know, after watching the episode, it makes sense. When he said he was only there once a month, I thought, well, I mean, you own the bar. How can you only be there once a month? Bless you, Amir. But it makes it makes sense that, you know, he does, you know, I guess it gets to a point. When you have those addictive personalities, it does get to a point. You have to make a choice, mm-hmm. your addiction or your family.
Yeah.
And so that does make sense that he strayed away from the bar. And it but, makes sense yeah. why what happened has happened.
Yeah. Well, we should talk about, though, when, you know, John pulled up mm-hmm. with Chef Aaron and Joe Brooks. Mm-hmm. And they sent in Renee and Brad
yes.
from Rax. Which, Rax, by the way, that episode is the episode that got me hooked on this
nice.
Show. It really was. Mm-hmm. I, we were like, what is this? And then we watched the marathon.
I remember. Okay, I remember you telling me too
yeah,
before we started this.
Exactly.
That you had watched.
I'd watched the marathon because I couldn't. I was like, there was two things. We were watching Rax and going, are you kidding me? And then going, John Taffer never blinks. So we love you, John Taffer, but seriously.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
And okay. so we watched it and we just fell in love with the whole concept of the show. Mm-hmm. So I was really happy to see Renee and Brad back. And what I thought was quite interesting, though, they go in and then you have Chef McCargo and Brooke mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. John in the car watching everything. And Terry is drinking with everyone. And
yes.
he's taunting Taffer on the cameras.
Yeah.
Cheersing. And I was just
digging
like,
that.
What a D-bag.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he
I
knew.
Was, yeah,
he knew.
Yeah, and he knew what he was doing, and he thought he was being smart and funny, which it wasn't smart and funny. There's a reason why that man is walking into your bar to fix it. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was hysterical because the man is tiny, and when Taffer walked in, because he's huge.
Right.
He still had nothing. Like, it still didn't bother him. I felt like that man just didn't care.
Well, you know what? I feel like the timing.
Hell to the law.
Love that. I feel like the timing, something is a little off with the structure of the timing on this, because he obviously was showcased at the bar that
yeah.
when he was in that video of drinking, taking all the shots. I don't think it was the one time he was at the bar. So that was obviously before.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering, his absence in the bar was obviously before
yeah.
Taffer as well.
Yeah, so I find that interesting because it made it seem like he was there all
yes,
the time.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But it definitely happened before because
yeah.
before he decided to vacate the bar
yeah.
for his family.
Yeah, and it probably was a problem because he's sitting
yes.
there drinking with his friends or drinking with customers. And
well, from the video, too, when he was shot time, it didn't seem like the customers actually wanted to take shots. They're like, oh, we're fine with our pitcher of beer.
Yeah.
But they were doing it to appease him.
Of course, because you always do to appease the bar owner.
Mm-hmm.
And the girls were even saying at points, like, Terry comes in, he buys everyone around, and what happens, and I know this one way too well, mm-hmm. is then what happens are the customers just waits for the owner to buy everybody around again, or waits for them to buy drinks, because then they're not going to spend money, then they're not going to tip the girls like they should be tipping the girls
regardless
mm-hmm. no matter what. And we have this whole situation on how they're losing money
mm-hmm.
on top of a bar that smells to the high heaven.
Well, you know, I think this has a lot to do with their competitiveness towards each other too. Because, you know, the fight for the money, the what little money was there, and the fact that most of them, the older ones, the veterans, they're not
mm-hmm.
old, but the veterans, they have families, they have children, you
yes.
know, and this is their main source of income. Then you have the younger ones who probably don't have as many responsibilities, and they're taunting. They're newer.
They don't get it. And
mm-hmm.
what I didn't understand, and from what I took from that, mm-hmm. and I don't know if you took that, I guess it's not a pooled house. So it was like whatever those girls made, that is what that girl made. Like
right.
they weren't pooling together.
Correct.
And that is awful for a bar. Awful.
That is what happened, though.
Yeah, that's the way I took it.
Remember that one of the girls, the veterans, was like, you know, I know who my customers are. I know how much they're going to tip, and I want a piece of that.
Exactly.
So she's going to take a piece of that from a piece of hers. And
it's just, and to me, is when you work that way,
mm-hmm.
nothing gets done. And
right.
then it just becomes nobody works with each other. And we saw that.
Mm-hmm.
We
mm-hmm.
saw that they would yell at each other. They would, it was awful.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they definitely weren't working as a team. I mean, they didn't share money as a team. They They weren't working as a team. They weren't making drinks as a team. That whole bar, I mean, it was ridiculous.
Yeah, and I'm sure that they could have all made a lot more money if they had worked together.
Right. Oh, of course.
I mean, it is what it is. Mm-hmm. If people work together and they all have a common goal mm-hmm. for a common good, you always do better.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I don't know.
It's a village, Dorinda.
I think by the end of the show, they did have a village. Hey, guys, we real quick want to just do a shout out to iTunes. We want to thank you so much for all the downloads and for leaving us comments, for rating us, referring a friend. So thank you so much. And this is the final episode, so just know that you can go back to YouTube and watch all of our season's recaps. You can also go to iTunes and download all of the season's recaps. Get yourself all ready for season 3, which we've got 20 episodes we're going to be recapping for season 3. So we got our work cut out for us. We have a surprise guest on the phone. It's Nancy Hadley. She does the production designing for Bar Rescue. Hi, Nancy.
Hello, how are you guys doing?
We're doing good. How you doing? How's your little girls, by the way?
How's Lux Bar?
Oh, they're doing wonderfully. Say a big hello.
Tell them we said hi.
Lesper. No, what did I call her last time? Lesper.
Lesper.
I think I actually said her name right the first time. Now I just said it wrong. That's great. We were just getting ready to, Nancy, go into talking about the experts real quick.
Right.
That he brought in. And so I guess we could start off with the kitchen, because there really wasn't too much to the kitchen. It seemed like the majority of the episode was on the bar and training those bikini-clad young ladies. And and then the redo at the end, the restructure.
Yeah. It had an interesting layout in the kitchen. It was pretty narrow.
Yes.
And then there was a wall that separated the cooktop from where the sink was. And then there was an unusual sort of office area for the chef.
Oh.
So
yeah, we didn't see that.
We had to do a little bit of reconfiguration, mm-hmm. and the old stovetop was a disaster. It was a nightmare.
Well,
it was just trashed.
I mean, the cook seemed really, really, really pleased with Chef McCargo's new menu. It's so easy, and we were all sitting here when we were watching it. It looks so good. It's like, I want to go home and make a triple-dipple-decker hot dog or whatever that thing was.
Oh, wait, that was a triple play.
Holy cow.
That thing looks so good.
Yeah, there was, I think it was a club sandwich, and there were some people that I knew that came to the relaunch and said that it was incredible.
Nice.
Really good.
Oh, nice.
Guaranteed you'd have some kind of, a lot of grease.
Yeah,
and a lot of
course.
A lot of extra calories, but that's perfect for that kind of venue.
Of course. Yeah, I was surprised.
Why your stomach?
Yeah, exactly. Right. I was surprised, but yet not so much surprised. I'm not sure if anything really surprises me anymore when we see gross kitchens and all the filth. It's so funny because Amir, our engineer here with us this evening, was like, oh my gosh, where is that bar? And it's like, Amir, those kind of bars are everywhere. Because he's like, that's an Orange? There's no dirty bars over an Orange. And it's like, you would be so surprised.
It was gross.
At the amount of dirty kitchens and dirty bars in LA in general.
I mean, you're
going to feature 20 next season.
Place.
We kept hearing that over and over and over and over. The stench.
If there was smell-o-vision, people would turn their TVs off because it was by far the grossest smell.
Like
I have smelled
old. I mean, one guy said it smelled like piss. So was it like an old, musty smell, or did it smell like?
It was like a combination of old diapers and rotted yeast. It's
fantastic.
Nasty. Yeah.
That's a good visual.
It was heavy. You walked in and it knocked you down.
Amir just threw up in his mouth.
Amir, he just threw up a little in his mouth.
Well, I'm really glad they redid the kitchen, obviously. Now, I mean, the cook seems so happy about it, and the menu was easy for him to do.
For him, he was having so much trouble before. I mean, you saw what happened with Renee and Brian and that, and the calamari.
Oh, yeah. I love it when they bring back people from past episodes. I like it when they integrate them.
They were probably my favorite because she was so sharp. I loved watching her. She knew exactly what to ask, what to watch for.
Mm-hmm.
poised herself so they could see what was going on. It was just really, really great. She learned so much from John and shared it. Oh. So it was definitely a pay it forward moment, and Renee just lost it.
I'm just so happy to see them and to see, like, they made that work. They made their bar work. You know, and I was happy to see that her and Brad were still there working together. Like, that was, to me, the best part of this episode.
And that's awesome that that's what started it for you, too.
Yeah, it is what started it for me.
And it ended for you as well.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool. That's a moment.
Yeah. They were a good example of people that listened to John, employed his recommendations and his sciences, and they just flew with it. Mm-hmm. Great job.
Mm-hmm. Kudos to them. Whoop, shout outs.
Yeah. Yeah. Yay, Renee. Yay, Brian. I love her. That's all I'd say. I do.
So I have to ask you, what about that floor? Fixing that floor.
Are
that
in the bar?
Yeah, in the bar.
Okay, so like,
that
wait,
was disgusting.
No, the one right behind the bar where the bartenders stood. They were on a raised platform. It's probably about 12, 13 inches higher than the main floor.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. We think they did that so they could just run the plumbing on the floor and raise and build above it. But unfortunately, they had had some kind of leak in the beer system that they did not address. And so when we lifted up that plywood and looked under there, the damage was... We didn't know how far the damage went, but we did know that in order to fix that, we couldn't have gotten through the permit process in time. So on John's recommendation, we wanted to make it palatable in there, so we put in disinfectant and redid that. We removed the rotted plywood and put down treated plywood so to buy them time. But I was really clear through production to make sure the owner knew it was on him now to truly follow up with that, because we didn't have the time to do it the way I personally would have liked to do it, but we just didn't have the timeline. So what he has there is, you know, a project. He had done something with the other side because that must have rotted. But what ideally is he should take out the whole thing and replumb it and decide whether he wants to keep the raised bar or drop it down. But I think the raised bar was an advantage for the show of the bartenders. Part of their whole thing is how beautiful the girls are and they serve you, and you can see more of them if they're raised up.
Right. Yeah, and they look a little more Amazonian.
Yeah, a little
That's
bit.
That's true.
So, so he did have a task, and I hope, because he seemed to be getting it at the end, I hope that he put that on the top of his to-do list. When the money starts to pour in from hopefully incredible success, the name itself just, I think, locks it.
I really, really liked the whole, the theme. Yeah. And the fact that everything, the food, the outfits, the new uniforms, the bar drinks, everything now ties in together. Even the color, you know, the outside, how it was painted. It looks amazing.
Yeah, it really,
really looks amazing.
It was invisible on the street before. I wrote an article for John's Nightclub and Bar online magazine that kind of talks about first impressions driving up and then how we addressed what we did. And the transformation was great. And John's thoughts on sports bars and what a sports bar is, it reminded me of the OP on what is a dive bar. There are people that, you know, open bars and they think they know what they're doing. But there are fundamental things that people expect walking into those places. They expect a good sports package. They expect good views of televisions that are not dated. They expect, you know, language and things to relate to the interest of the bar. If you're going to call yourself a sports bar, they were definitely a neglected basement bar that, you know, needed to complete the thought, basically, and John was able to help them do that.
Well, do you think, Nancy, that it started going downhill when the owner made the decision that he really couldn't be in that type of environment anymore?
Well, possibly. I can't really make a judgment call on that because I didn't see how he ran it before. But he, you know, on Scout night when John was meeting with him, apparently he didn't go there very often, but the way he behaved on that Scout night just blew my mind. Now, if he was a glad-handing mayor of the bar all the time, then you do gather in a certain circle of people that will follow you. But whether or not that's lucrative, I don't know. And that night was just flat out the weirdest thing I've ever seen from a business standpoint.
Of course, of course.
And he knew he knew John could be coming in. So
I know. I mean, they were egging on. They were, I mean, taking shots in front of the camera. He knew that John was going to see that. John was watching, you know? Or people from Spike were watching.
But, you know, I think it's funny. People want help, and then they challenge the help. That never ceases to amaze me.
He totally challenged the help.
It's like Bar Rescue for teenagers.
Right. Well, yeah.
And I, you know, the resistance, I don't always understand. The way he seemed to come around, I was very happy with.
Because yes.
It's all about the bottom line and the money and his business, really. Mm-hmm. And if he can make that work, then it's for him. It's not that John is fighting him. It's John that's fighting for him.
Right. Well, once again, you know, the other expert, drink mixer specialist. Oh, my God. I just mixed the two words together. Get it? Mix specialist.
Oh. Speed tender.
Speed tender Joe Brooks. I was very impressed. Again, he seems so knowledgeable. It's like I would love to learn from him. It's like he's got this assertiveness about him, but you could tell he's a stand-up guy.
Yeah, and he totally loves what he does.
Yes, and I Googled him, and there is so much stuff on him. It's he's definitely accomplished, you know? It's like it makes me want to go wherever he is just so I can have a drink made by him. Just, wow. You know, and I just, the way he was with those girls and making the drinks for them and helping them with their pours, and I think that he was the perfect person for this episode, especially with that amount of girls who really had no idea what they were doing.
Yeah. Like they needed a lot of tutoring, and plus, because there was a dynamic of the competition in there.
Oh, Lord.
The way he approached them to team together as opposed to team apart was really, really smart.
Now,
what they needed.
Now, Nancy, here's my question, because they didn't say this in the episode. Did they still keep in that whole each girl for themselves mentality, or did they start doing a pool house? That's the question I really wanted answered, and I felt that wasn't answered. Did they keep their old way where it was each girl for themselves, or did they pool the house? Because, I mean, the girls were working together by the end, but who knows?
No, unfortunately, I don't have the answer for that. They did work as a team on that relaunch night.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one thing that I did not follow, whether or not they were pooling their tips and then splitting it up at the end. That would be the best way to do it.
Yeah, it would make sense, though, to do that. I mean, everything else has changed. Yeah. They need to encourage the team mentality. And so and with the new GM, the gentleman that's the new GM.
Gary.
I would assume that since he hasn't given control to take over and do what needs to be done, where before he obviously didn't have the control to do anything, and nobody in the bar had any control to really do anything either, and which I'm sure was also a reason that all that animosity was created, you know?
Yes. And so hopefully if he was taking notes on how to, you know, decrease that competitiveness. I mean, you want a certain degree of competitiveness, but it should be for the team, and then you split up. So honestly, I don't know. Hopefully they did that, because that would stop a lot of that in its tracks and just do it as a per night split. I agree.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I don't think I've ever been in a bar except for Saddle Ranch that does that they're ever successful at. And Saddle Ranch, I mean, to me, isn't even that successful with it, because it's off-putting to the customers at times.
Well, right, and it can get pretty aggressive. It's like going to a car
it's
dealer.
It's very aggressive.
Going for a commission.
Mm-hmm.
But what did level the playing field was the uniforms. I think that they helped a lot, because then you know, I mean, not that anyone was going to walk in there with a bikini on and be mistaken for staff, but it just gave the place more of a style. I don't know if you've already talked about that, but I just wanted to throw that in. But the uniforms, I thought that was a good way to go, and keeping the bikini, the fun look, especially for the
Nancy, we
patrons.
Started off with the whole bikini thing, really.
What?
We started off talking about the bikinis.
Oh, I'm so late. Well, you know, it was my intention, and then I didn't do it in the end, but my team, at least my electricians, were willing. We were going to surprise John, and everyone was going to be in bathing suits just to be funny when he walked in while we were finishing up the makeover. But I'm really
that would have been hilarious.
Now, those are pictures I would like to see.
I thought it would have been hilarious, but...
Oh, man. See, oh, that's a fun crew.
What could have been.
Right?
You know, everybody had their pride.
So, Nancy, did everybody seem pretty happy with the outcome, with, you know, all the perks that you guys were able to make for them and all the redos with the floor and the bar? And I noticed that they had new glassware, which is great.
Yes, they had great new glassware, which they needed desperately.
Uh-huh.
From everything that I had heard, and because the one thing that I gave as an aside regarding the floor and our limitations with doing anything more than we had. The furniture, they loved that we repaired the bar top because they had a granite bar top, but it was slumping,
mm-hmm.
and it looked like it was going to give way. So there were things we did that you wouldn't know from the before and after.
Right.
But we corrected things that were neglected, and there were many, many neglected things.
How does marble slump? I mean, I thought it was pretty marble. I didn't realize
there were two sheets of marble, but the bar itself was not reinforced.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So it was it was starting to drop at one of the seams in the center of the bar. So we were able to get that shored up and take notes on, which I love. John wanted us to have some fun with, you know, numbering the television so that the sound system, you could watch any TV you wanted.
Yep.
And when you dial in, you could hear the audio on that TV. I thought that was great. So you knew what you were looking at.
Oh, that was fantastic.
I mean, it's such a simple thing. Any bar can do that. And it cost you the price of either a permanent marker or stickers and then the sound system.
Right.
Yeah, actually, one of my friends owns a sports pub in Texas, and she was watching it. She actually called me, and she said she wrote that down, and she's going to find out more about that.
Yeah, that
she thinks it's fantastic.
I had mentioned it to my husband, and before that had aired, I told him about that, and he was really excited. He said, that's excellent. You know, he's a big sports fan. So just the idea that you can customize your area.
Right.
Then the other thing we did, we changed lighting. They had black lights over the bar, so whenever the bartenders smiled, their smile was green. So I removed all of that because that did not help.
No.
I mean, that wasn't intentional, right?
You see a beautiful woman in a bikini, and then she smiles green because there's a black light over her head.
No, that's not good. That's only good in Mr. Toad's world,
right? I'm not sure what the plan was there. Maybe they used body paint at some point or whatever, but more of a, you know, traditional lighting system with pendants and things, and added a couple little fun touches like the chain link behind some of the windows to kind of imply a cage, batting cage.
Right.
And, and the bleacher seating near the pool table I thought would be fun and kind of funny because you could actually observe a pool tournament from bleachers and be drinking. And then we named different areas.
So much we didn't see.
Keep track.
There's so much we didn't see.
Yeah. There was the dugout. There was the batter's box.
That I saw, which I loved.
They could map the floor and say, okay, you're taking the dugout tonight, and you're taking the bleachers, and, you know.
Right.
And there was a floor in the middle of the floor. It was all concrete, but there was this floating wood floor. Floating wood floor in the middle of the floor. We didn't quite understand what that was about. And then one restaurant booth seat that was the nastiest piece of furniture I've seen also.
In the middle of the floor?
In the middle of the room. Where we ended up putting some high-top tables. And we would never have even wanted to recover this piece of furniture. I didn't even want to touch it. It was that bad.
Ooh.
So we removed that. So there were things that were just neglected and just left there, like nobody had a thought what to do with it, so they just covered it up. There was a sheet or some kind of piece of fabric over that booth seat. It was just nasty.
Oh.
And then the gum that I pulled off the bottom of things.
Ew, Nancy!
Those are the things you don't see, but we do.
Right, of course. I wouldn't mind. I think it'd be great to have, like, an episode where it's all these outtakes. Because I know you guys have so much footage, of the nasty.
Oh, yes.
So how do you feel about this? I mean, it's done. It's done until next season. Did you get,
right.
Are we going to be able to see you on many episodes of season 3?
You know, I don't think you're going to see me on episodes of season three. I am not going back for season three.
Okay.
I'm going to work on some more design, independent design.
Got it.
And I am going to do the nightclub and bar show in Vegas, so that will be fun, where I can kind of share some of the things I've learned on the road and things that I know about design and just getting patrons' attention.
Is this in November?
Keeping their attention.
November, Nancy?
That is in March, I believe.
Oh, okay, okay, okay.
Yeah, it's the NCB show in Las Vegas that they put on.
Okay.
That's a great venue. It's really, really amazing. Incredible vendors out there and people basically launching some of their new products.
So. Nice. Well, tell everybody, what is your Facebook so people can stay up with you? Because we've had so many, I mean, you've got a lot of fans here. So what what is your Facebook page where you're posting all the before and after pics and people can read all your articles, which is going to link them to the nightclub and bar newsletter. So what is it?
Oh, my Facebook page is Nancy Hadley, designer/artist.
Okay.
And you can like that page, and then I link to my website when I'm uploading fun before and after makeovers for shows, private makeovers, and some of the other projects that I have coming up.
Nice.
This fall.
And what's your Twitter handle, Nancy?
My Twitter handle is Art Nanners.
Oh, yeah, that's it. I'm like waiting for the at Gmail, at MSN. And I'm like, oh, that is that.
At Art Nanners. Yeah, that's it.
At Art Nanners. Okay, Nancy. Thank you.
So
glad you could join us for the finale. We're very excited. We've had so much fun.
And thank you guys for recapping it. It's been really fun hearing your thoughts and hearing the questions. And anybody, you know, anyone can email me on my Facebook page if you have any additional questions. I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you for being so accessible.
Yeah, no problem. Take care, you guys.
All right,
thank
lady.
Thank you, Nancy. Mm-hmm. Tell the girls we said hi.
I will.
Bye-bye. Bye. Bye. Dorinda, do you have which one was your favorite episode for this season?
Gosh.
I'm sad that it's over.
I know. I mean, it is sad. I mean, there are so many that I liked. I really liked J.A. Murphy's.
We're sad.
I did like J.A. Murphy's because I like the name Murphy's Law.
Yes.
Aura. Mystique, I guess it was called before.
Yep.
That was a great one. Of course, pirates. You can't leave the season without saying anything about pirates.
You know what? When we come back for episode three, we should do a little recap. We will. We'll do a little recap. We're going to take like 10 minutes and talk about where the bars are at quickly. If they're still open or if they're closed. Get a little, you know, diddle daddle. I just made that up too. Get a little bit from each of the owners and, you know, just giving us a heads up on what's going on with them, and we'll recap that way for people that really didn't see season two yet or might not have caught up yet. We can give them a little, you know, a brief bio and everything that's gone on. Just description. Did I say bio? Whatever. Description on the show and pull them in so they start watching Bar Rescue.
Yeah, and before we end the show, I would definitely love to shout out to Chef Capone, Nancy Hadley, John Taffer, Nicole Taffer, for calling in, for definitely being part
Chef
of
Brian.
This. Chef Brian Duffy.
Katie.
Oh, Katie. All the owners who were so generous with their time and being honest with us and saying you know, what was on their mind, because this was their platform for them to actually get out what they wanted to say and what they thought about the show. And it really has, you know, gave us a whole different light on the show itself. I mean, we love it and we're fans of it, but we also really appreciate it from where you guys came from and your standpoint.
For sure. I think it definitely made our recaps. It made it more fun.
Yeah.
You know, get a little bit of dirt here and there. That's always good.
Oh, of course. Who doesn't love a little dirt?
Well, again, a huge thank out. Thank you. A thank out? That's supposed to be shout out. And thank you. What is going on? It's like I'm combining so many words. Thank you guys so much. Again, iTunes. Watch us on YouTube. And you guys, any questions you have now until, you know, Bar Rescue, the season three, when we come back to do the recaps. You guys will answer. We'll keep asking, answering the questions that you guys have. So we do have a connection with Bar Rescue, and so we're able to get information for you guys. So thank you so much again. It's been a great, great season.
And I know they're still looking for bars, too. So if you do know of any bars that you feel need a rescue, you can get in touch with us, and we can get in touch with the right people.
Absolutely. Make sure you follow. We're going to give you our Twitter handles. You can follow me at Kimlai Yingling.
And then you can follow me at Lula Cherry Films.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in and catching us every Monday night. We'll see you for season three.
Bye, guys.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principal.